So I'm going to share some of my journey with you, but I want to start with and end with three core elements, which if you don't listen to anything else, please just listen to this. It's know thyself, know thy risk, and know thy value. Really interesting listening to all of you guys and all of your ideas. Lots of similarities, lots of differences in approach. But what I didn't hear anybody talk about, and it might be the nature of the exercise, is why you? Why you are the best people to do this? Who are the team? Why are we the guys that know what we're doing in this space? And ultimately, when you do real startups in the real world, trying to get money off the guys up there in Old Street, they need to know first and foremost who the team are and why they would back them versus anyone else. Because sure as hell, you're not the first guys to have come up with, you know, a delivery service, you know, or some kind of luxury service, hotels or coffee or whatever it might be. You're not the first guys to have come up with that, and you sure as hell won't be the last. But it doesn't mean you can't win, but it means there's other really important factors in there. And for me, the only way that I can move forwards in life is knowing that I've like robustly considered any decision that I've been making, so I don't have to revisit it. And so I was talking with Jen earlier about how the real difference comes in any project in the last 10%. Everybody kind of looks the same for 90% of the time. It's in the last 10% that you really see whether people like went through that rigorous process of figuring out why this versus anything else. Because that's when people quit or when they dig their heels in and make it happen. And so the first thing really is about knowing thyself. What are you good at? What are you passionate about? What is the thing that only you can do, you know, on the basis of various different areas of life that you're passionate about and have had experiences in, good or bad? When you know that, you can then figure out what your weaknesses are, you can get other people around you and build a robust team that other people, most importantly, can believe in. Then it's about knowing your risk. So it's about knowing, like, let's get really honest with ourselves. Are we trying to create the next Google here? Or are we just trying to do something that's a bit of fun that basically takes as few risks as possible and makes as much money as possible? They're two totally different things. And if you or your team have a different, essentially, risk profile, you can find all sorts of problems later down the road, because that is fundamentally the go-to point for figuring out what kind of strategy you have, what kind of chunks of your value chain should you be taking, how disruptive should you be? You know, how many assumptions in society should you be challenging? And then the third area is know thy value. What is the actual value to a person that you are creating in your business? Why is it unique? How is it beneficial? And to what value is it beneficial in someone's life? And then ask the question, how do we capture that value we've created? You know, if you don't capture it, you're not an effective business. You're just a cool tool, you know, and there's plenty of cool tools around, but very hard to build a compelling business that captures all of the value they create. So I guess that's the simplest way I could summarize my journey over the last few years, has been trying to figure out, how do I know myself? How do I know what kind of risks I'm willing to and what risks I'm not willing to take? What value can I create? How do I capture that in a way that can grow a scalable global institution? And so I'll take you back to the start. For me, I started managing people's ads on Google. When I was 19, I set up a company with a few mates and we just managed ads on Google, teaching ourselves, getting a bit of help from the Dublin crew from Google. And after a couple of years, we grew it to about 20 staff. We had about 150 customers, managing about 5 million a year of ad spend. I was like, at one point, I was the oldest at 19. 17, 18, and 19, we all were following the Google culture of table tennis and pool and all the rest. It was a great laugh, it was awesome. It's now grown up to about 200 employees in different countries. But I got out when I was 21 and I sold to a guy that wanted to consolidate the market. So obviously I learned a lot there about startups, but I also learned about online return on investment and the ability through doing business online to create feedback loops that allow you to unequivocally know how much value is being created through your advertising strategy. And therefore, I was really, really, the most enjoyable part of the job was taking little kitchen companies from spending 300 quid a month on Google, not knowing anything about whether it was working for them or not. All they know is the phone rings sometimes, you know, and they're still in business, to actually putting the right analytics in place, the right ROI tracking and funneling, to figure out that actually this is bloody brilliant and it's the best channel they've got, and growing them up to like 15 grand a month, which for them was like revolutionary for their company. So that was awesome, but I began to get these kind of inklings of wanting, I kind of got a bit bored with sort of selling poochy petware and pest control and things like that, and my brain started going on to some wider concepts about what is value, you know, what is valuable for society, what work is essentially worth doing, which is where I started to ask the questions of, you know thyself, you know, what is it that I can do? And kind of ask the questions, what do I believe in, you know, and what skills do I have? And really the question that mattered to me most and still matters to me most is, what needs to be done? That's a very, very broad and generic question. It was intentionally that way because I wasn't being presumptuous that any one sector has more value to offer society than any other. Am I more valuable to just buy a house with no mortgage and invite people to come and live with me that don't have a home or don't have family? Or is it more valuable to try and become a politician or to run a charity, to run a company, to support other people running those charities or companies in Africa? Or, you know, I looked at every sort of solution from big to small, and that led me to loads of places. I traveled with Jane Goodall in the States. I spent time with Jamie Drummond, who started the One Campaign or Make Poverty a History. I've, you know, hustled all sorts of characters along the way to try and get a little bit of their knowledge. Because the thing that scared me the most was somebody told me that these electric turbines, the kind of windmills, they take more energy to create than they'll ever produce in their life cycle. Now, I'm not saying that's true. I don't know what is true, but it scared the crap out of me because I thought, what if I spend the rest of my life sort of touting some solution for society that ends up becoming meaningless for society, and I've wasted all my energy sort of trying to be a decent bloke and then realizing it was all a load of guff anyway. So it really made me want to go deep in trying to figure out what actually matters, you know, and what is valuable. Just slightly after that, it kind of blended into a season where I learned about mobile payments. I realized that, you know, this kind of mobile, social, local paradigm shift is not just a new channel opening up, but like something that's fundamentally changing how society works, you know, how we do all of our content and commerce and communication. And it's not just a siloed extra channel, but something that will blend more intuitively and naturally with our lifestyles. And soon mobiles will become defunct, but that sense of the web being a part of us, you know, and our digital identity sitting naturally on top of our natural or physical identity will continue for a long time, I'm sure. So I needed to understand it. So I started a mobile business incubator, and we started working on different mobile projects. I mentioned to some of you earlier, we built an app for Mr. and Mrs. Smith, the boutique hotel guys. We launched a luxury mobile commerce platform, and I launched kind of a charity platform to do some micro donations. And it became hard, as you can imagine, to do a lot of different projects at once. I was unable to get investment for three businesses at a time. And so essentially I was asked the question, you know, focus, you know, what is the one thing that you're going to focus on? Because we'll invest in that, but we won't invest in you doing three or four things. And that was very, very hard for me because I realized that essentially having more than one plate spinning is a way to avoid failure. It's a way to avoid putting all of your identity into one thing. And most things have never really felt interesting enough or complicated or hard enough that I can be an underdog enough to actually put all of myself into them. But in the end, I decided that the only project that I'd be willing to put 10 years of my life into and it still fail was essentially the prototype to Givi at the time. And this is where I kind of bring the journey together, because I kind of spent 2 or 3 years learning about online marketing and how to create value there for small businesses. I then asked for about 2 years really, traveled and asked the question, what needs to be done? What work is useful? And then I spent a couple of years learning about this mobile social paradigm shift. And kind of when I blended all those together, I was able to answer the question like, you know, the know thyself point, you know, this is something that only I can do. Not because I'm the best, not because I'm smarter than anybody else, but just because I have a unique set of ingredients that leads me to this point. And that means when, as I've gone through very recently, some bloody difficult times, it makes it easier to carry on and not quit because you know that there's nothing else that's worth doing. And it just struck me that I know this is just a project, you're just trying to figure some stuff out, but you know, that's an important thing to ask the question, you know, whether it's, whether you work, continue working for agencies, whether you spin out and do your own stuff, you've got to be able to answer those questions for your own sanity, you know, because otherwise your mind goes mental thinking, should I be doing something else? Especially if you start tasting some success, because then some inquiries start coming in from left, right and center, and you think, oh, maybe I'll do that. Maybe this looks a little bit better. Maybe I shouldn't be doing this anymore. So that's the first thing. Second thing is about know thy risk. So once I focused on what I was going to do, you have to start getting investors on board, you have to start getting team on board. And it's very hard to do that if you don't set the agenda, set the culture and set the strategy. You can only do that if you know how much risk you're willing to take. Because, you know, our strategy from day one was go big or go home. And as you can imagine, that sort of sets a bit of an agenda for what the investors' expectations are, what the team's expectations are. And essentially the strategy and culture of the organization. So that was about 3 years ago. We took on about 100 grand of investment, went through a tech accelerator called Ignite 100. We worked, did some work with Google actually, we did some work with Microsoft, raised $1 million at the end of 2012 for Givi from hardcore venture backed, or VCs, sorry. And then set about building our business model. And this is probably the part that makes more sense to what you guys are doing right now, which is, I thought really, really hard about what value is being created in the online donation space, in the mobile donation space, and what is a good way to charge for that value if you're creating it. Because I think we're charging value potentially for individuals, making value for charities, and hopefully making value for businesses as well. I was convinced that I wanted businesses to be a part of the value chain. But who do you charge and why do you charge them? And that's the next question. Know your value and then know how to capture it. And I really was dissatisfied with the platforms out there, you'll know, like Just Giving and Virgin, who take a percentage of your donation between 3% and 7%. And they also charge charities. And it's not actually that that's like wrong, but it's just that they're not very transparent about it. You know, how many people here knew that those platforms take a percentage of your donation? Maybe a quarter, a third, maybe a third of people. And I think, you know, transparency, simplicity, and clarity are three words, principles that underpin all the work that I do. Just Giving could charge 30% if they wanted to. If they make it clear to you, you're then empowered to make a choice about whether that's something that you want to participate in or not. You may deem that to be valuable enough, the service they offer, to accept that percentage. I wanted to think about it differently and look at a different way to charge that would actually build a bigger business. Because in the grand scheme of things, these companies are actually very small, you know, 100 odd employees, a small number of millions of turnover rather than your Facebooks, Twitters and Amazons, who are in the billions of dollar valuations, obviously. And so I started to think, what if we could make it free for charities, free for individuals? How would we make money? How would we capture the value? And realized if we bring businesses in, we can charge them for the privilege of being able to match their employees or their customers' giving. And that means that actually the market is a lot bigger for us in terms of how we can create revenue, because we're not just limited to the transactional values of the donations. If we make giving strategic for businesses, so bringing in back from the online marketing days, actually provide return on investment, that means that businesses can consider their giving spend as an investment rather than a donation that gets lost in the ether, then we can increase their spend, much like I did with the little kitchen companies, taking them from a few hundred quid, not really knowing what's going on, up to hopefully 15 grand a month, you know, knowing this is awesome for our business, you know. Because there's a lot of research out there that shows that employee engagement is massive. It is massively increased if you can engage with them over charitable things, over things that they care about. And so we just have to prove that we can do that and do it well and provide the right reporting that allows whoever it was that is in charge of that spend to put it back to their leadership table and say, this is why we spend that money. And so that has really been the agenda, because if you look at GDP in the UK, charity giving is less than 1% of it. So it's a very small part of our economy, even though we're, you know, listed as being one of the most generous countries in the world. But if you look at like the marketing part of GDP, it's flipping massive. So if we can link giving to that part of the pie where people are marketing either to their internal employees or they're marketing to their customers, then we have a chance to exponentially increase the amount of giving that's done in the UK. So that all sounds very good, doesn't it? You know, a bit of fun, but it's been a bloody hard slog. You know, it's been about 3 years now. We set about building that business model last year. It's probably everything's taken me probably three times longer than I hoped it would. But somehow you don't quite hit the rocket and you don't die. You just keep trundling on, and it goes back to some of those decisions we made back in the day. And we wanted to make some big punts, you know. So if we're looking at this kind of risk curve, you know, we were up there. We were up to the right. You know, we're basically saying we want to revolutionize the way that giving works, or we want to go home. You know, we want to make giving a small part of people's daily lives, because I won't bore you with it now, but neurologically and from a behavioral economics perspective, if we can make it a small part of daily life, the knock-on effects for how we consider ourselves in society, in culture, are essentially our likelihood to help a stranger is dramatically increased. You know, I can't measure all that, and I can't incentivize helping a stranger, but if we can create some mechanisms that drive those kinds of behaviors and those kinds of neurological processes, then that's a very exciting thing to do. And we're like, let's go for it or go home. That's basically been the deal from day one. So everybody that comes to intern for me, that comes to work with me, they all know the deal. They all know that their jobs are horridly on the line and we might not get another year, because it is very hard to move these things forwards. So that kind of brings us up to about now, really. You know, I raised $1 million at the end of 2012. Like, hurrah, you know, we're doing really well. We got out of the mire of the kind of the old street roundabout, kind of every Tom, Dick and Harry with an app that they've sort of half built and got a deck for, and we're doing really well. And then like, I tried to do this online crowdfunding thing at the beginning of the year, which kind of went wrong for various different reasons to do with my venture capital funds and them not being able to display the money that they were putting in the round, which meant that the whole thing didn't get momentum and failed. And then you're like, oh, that's not part of the plan. That's not what was meant to happen next. We were meant to just take that curve. And then you kind of start running out of money, you know, running out of your runway of cash, and you start going, oh shit, I've actually got to speak to my staff now and say that the jobs actually are almost on the line. And then at the end of March, it's like, oh, we've run out of money, guys, you know. So we've got to start thinking about getting other jobs, you know. And then you're like, oh dear. Because I was hoping that another new CEO would come in place and that I wouldn't have to move the business forwards. I thought there'd be a better person at this point once we'd articulated what Givi is. And so it's been about a month ago, I had the real crunch where you really get to ask yourself, like, is it worth it? You know, shall I carry on? Shall we keep driving forwards? And, you know, it's a very quiet moment, really. It's a very sort of isolated thing, just sitting on my own. And to be honest, the moment it broke me was I came back from Newcastle, where a bunch of my guys are, and I was on the train coming back down, and I told them all that their jobs are in jeopardy and that, you know, we don't know what the future looks like. I'm trying to close a round offline now with the VCs, but it's complicated. And, you know, got off the final phone call, went into the toilet, burst out crying, sat there crying for 10 minutes. Then you just sort of, you know, wipe the tears off and fan yourself down, and then go sit down again and start writing more emails and carry on, because there's nothing else to do. Do you know what I mean? You accept that it hurts, but then you just crack on. But in that time, you know, I had a real chance to ask myself, do I want to do this? Like, do I need to do this? Because I could have ducked out quietly then, and no one would have said I quit, or I was that I just didn't try hard enough. We tried everything, we really did. And in that moment, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I was like, no, there is nothing else to do. There is no other work that I am interested in doing. And it is worth going to whatever degree I have to go to carry on. And you can't substitute those moments. You can talk about it, but it's this sounds like they're buzzing me off stage. No, you've gone on too long. Yeah. You can't substitute those moments. They're vital to your own sort of sense of commitment. You know, I know now that it doesn't really matter what happens next. Even if it goes a lot worse, I'm still gonna be in the game. But interestingly, in the last 3 weeks, a lot of stuff has started to fall into place. Actually, about 8 weeks ago, Money Saving Expert, if you know those guys, they listed us as the number one UK giving platform. I just went through our final investment committee to close a small 300K round. That gives us a decent runway. We'll probably close double that in the next 6 weeks. It's given me a chance to reconsider how I do be a good CEO, and I've realized that actually I need to, in order to grow this business, because I'm sure as hell not gonna try and raise finance without us getting to break even point again, because it gets harder and harder the longer you've been financed for. Think, oh, you've been doing this 4 years now, why haven't you made any money yet? So I know we need to get to break even ASAP, and I realize I need to come back to Surrey and take some of my guys who I've been working with in the past and really build, you know, combine them with the guys in Newcastle to build a really strong biz dev team, basically. So it's given me a chance to think about all those things, and I want to show you a little video. Morning all, hope you're well. I just arrived in Westminster, and today is an unusual day. I'm going to Buckingham Palace to meet the Queen. She's invited a bunch of technology people to come and have a reception at her house, which is very nice of her. But first I'm going to Parliament, because Givi has been included in a government research paper for how to change the flipping giving culture in the UK. So a very cool day. I got dressed up especially, and I'll try and take you with me as best I can.
All we need is a spark, a second chance, a lifeline. Waiting up in the dark, holding up for a searchlight. No, I don't know why seasons change or how we fell so far. Before our hearts go up in flames, let's go through.
But the vital question is, how can we make this change happen?
So I think what we're calling for in this report, and as David said, it is really a transformation, and really quite a radical overhaul in the way that employers help their employees to connect with charities and with social action. Now, absolutely, we have lots of great examples of companies, big and small, doing great things. And so there are some recommendations in the report to actually help employers to be able to do that sort of matching, which really does, all the evidence says, makes a really big difference. Lots of young people far more likely to want to work for an employer who's involved in this.
Employees want to feel proud of where they work. The best businesses know that, and best businesses know they have to support and recognise and value what their employees want to do in that.
That was a lot of fun and good to catch up with some old faces, and really exciting that most of the stuff that gets talked about in this report, Givi absolutely nails, and it really gets me fired up again. And now to go over to the lady's house who all these guys and girls in Parliament work for. So this is the invite I got from the Queen a few days ago. I'm going to show you what's in it.
Let the heat of the sun reignite your memory.
So I've written my note to the Queen, because I figure people probably don't really say thank you to her because they're probably scared of her. So I want to say thanks to her for inviting me round, but that I'd love to chat with her more, because I know she cares about giving and about how we treat one another. So may as well give her my number and see whether she wants to chat further. And Ella wrote, I know she's busy, but this is quite an important issue. Well, she's got my number. She can do what she wants. I am now pulling into the Mall, the driveway to the Queen's house, basically. So I might have to switch over to my iPhone in a second. Okay, so I'm now sitting outside Buckingham Palace waiting for my car to get checked, like these guys. Should I take the whole thing off?
Yeah, maybe, because I'll just walk over and just slip it on there. Like.
Perfect.
Okay, no problem.
Thank you. I don't know why no one's taking photos of my car.
Just send it to
Sorry.
No worries. Here we go, going into the gates. Well, this is probably the only time I'll ever drive through the gates at Buck Pal.
Excuse me?
Yeah, man.
Are you going to see the Queen now?
Hopefully.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, cool. Good luck.
Thank you, man. Yeah.
No problem.
It's good fun, isn't it?
Thanks, yeah.
Good evening.
Just speak to my colleague.
Sure. Hi, sir.
Can I see your green invitation
card? Yes, that's here.
Excellent, and a photo, excellent.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good afternoon. Just pop up behind
one of those rather nicer looking vehicles. Thank you. Well, hello, sir. now to hand deliver my note to the Queen, hopefully, unless I get rugby tackled in the process. So that's it, the end of the night. We're the last ones here. Met Prince William, met the Queen, had a nice chat with Prince William, met the Duke of Edinburgh, met Michael Birch from Bebo, a bunch of other guys. And it's time to go home before they lock me up for the night. But what a great day, Gibby getting established. Let's see what happens next. See you soon, guys. I should have hired a car as well. I've just driven home and got changed, and I guess I'm beginning to reflect on the day. And it was pretty nuts, pretty awesome. So glad I got to drive into the palace. That was freaking awesome. But it was kind of weird meeting the Queen, because you just go past and shake a hand and move on. Your name gets called out, but she can't. She doesn't have enough time to take in any of your story or who you actually are. So it's almost like a non-human experience. It's not like meeting anybody else ever. But meeting Prince William was totally different. He's engaging and listening. He moves on after a minute or two, but at least he's sort of heard who you are. So I don't envy her life at all. And I can only just hope that she has some real mates of her own that she gets to hang out with, whether that's up in Scotland or whatever. But what a great day. Thanks for coming with me. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will see you soon. So yeah, so that was my day yesterday, and I stayed up, you know, it wasn't that late actually, but got to bed about one, I guess, in the end after editing that together. But it was a good fun day, and I guess to bring it all back together, I'd say, you know, there are lots of ways of using technology that are obvious, you know, that are natural, because maybe that's a problem we want solving. But you will see a lot of like companies coming out at the moment, like Snapchat, for example, yeah. It's like, really, what does it do? You know, nothing really useful. It's like a, well, it's all right, we'll move on then. No, it's just a bit of fun, isn't it? And these valuations are crazy. And I just think technology can do so much more interesting things, you know, to actually unlock real value for people in their daily lives. And it's nice to see that some of the ideas you guys are working on are using web technology to at least connect real people to have real moments, rather than just like, you know, more kind of cyber relationships. And I think that's where the opportunity for the web is. Do any of you read Mary Meeker, by the way? Do any of you check out her Global Trends? Well, check out Mary Meeker from Kleiner Perkins in the States. She is like the authority on global trends and focuses in on internet trends. Her recent report just came out 2 weeks ago. Really interesting to me. What she basically says is internet usage in the Western world is kind of stable. In developing economies, it's growing rapidly. But the interesting opportunity for us is in really in the marketing space, in the advertising space. Print still has 20% of the ad spend, but only about 4% of our attention. Mobile has about 20% of our attention, but only about 5% of the spend. So every other sector and channel is kind of the amount of share of voice or share of attention is roughly equates to the amount of revenue in the space. But this is where there's a disparity, and this is where the big change is going to swing when those execs catch up to where people are actually spending their time and energy on their mobile, typically through social networks, and the spend will begin to move. So the opportunity that's biggest is about a $30 billion opportunity in the US, and that's the opportunity that I think is most exciting in terms of how we use technology today, is to try and find a way to connect people to things or other people through the mobile device, typically through social networks. And the real opportunity for me is to figure out how do you do that with maybe a better value set than is typically expected from marketing engines and the kind of products that get marketed to people typically. So how can we rearrange that? So going back to the beginning, know thyself, spend time on that, you know, even if you not thinking about doing a startup yourself. It's just so important. It helps you become more self-aware and help build team around you better. Know thy risk. Know actually what kind of risks excites you and what scares you, because then you can turn down things that are good but too low risk, and or take things that are up the higher risk graph, even if your mates aren't into that kind of thing. And know your value, you know, whether that's yourself or your product. Figure out what specifically is the value that I'm unlocking and creating in people's lives, and then be ruthless about trying to capture no more and no less than the fair value that you're actually creating in people's lives, and then you have a great business. That's all from me, so thanks for listening.